Hello guys, welcome back to Dr Ranjith, the pathology educator at Unacademy. So we are in the recall of NEET PG 2021 questions of which came in pathology. We have a total of 22 questions and we are in the fag end of the series. We have 20 questions and we are in the 28th question now. This is again a perfect integrative questions where you have information both from the clinical point of view as well as from your microscopic point of view, right? So we'll go with the question, we'll read and we'll decipher whatever the question is trying to convey to us from word by word, right? A 32-year-old female complains of weakness in the upper limb and there is a feeble peripheral pulses. So this would have given me very clear diagnosis. Feeble peripheral pulse, I'm sure all of you must have first thought of it, pulseless syndrome, right? And a biopsy of a large vessel showed giant cells and granuloma. So I'm having giant cells and granuloma, and the most important thing is biopsy of a large vessel, right? What's your most probable diagnosis? So I'm going to deal with something which is going to be in large vessel disease. So with that information, I can slightly rule out TAO because TAO affects my medium and my small size artery. I can slightly rule out PAN because PAN is predominantly a median vessel vasculitis. So you have only two possibilities. It could be either giant cell arteritis or your Takayasu arteritis, fine. So with pulseless disease, the feeble peripheral pulses, you will definitely first incline towards my Takayasu arteritis. That's also right in inclining, right? So I just want to convey here. See, I have two large vessel vasculitis, giant cell arteritis and Takayasu arteritis. Am I right in saying that both of them will involve all the large vessels in the body? Yes. So am I right in saying that can a giant cell arteritis involve subclavian artery? Is it correct? They can. So if a giant cell arteritis involves a subclavian artery, can they present with the feeble peripheral pulses? Yes, possible, right? So what's the other name of giant cell arteritis? It is temporal arteritis, right? So it's called temporal arteritis not because it involves temporal arteries more. It's easy superficial and it's easy for us to study. We study the entire disease pathogenesis based on the temporal artery biopsies. So it is named as temporal arteritis, that's all. So it's a giant cell arteritis, that's it. It can involve any vessel. But when I take Takayasu, the commonest involved artery is your subclavian artery. Based on that, your pulseless disease, everything comes into place. So in other words, both of these can involve anything. Giant cell arteritis can involve your subclavian artery. Takayasu arteritis can involve the temporal artery, your maxillary artery causing jaw claudication. So clinically, I will not be able to differentiate any of these. Now let's come to microscopy. So microscopy is unfortunately both a chronic inflammation. Both of them will have granulomas in microscopy. So microscopy also is extremely difficult for me to differentiate them. So clinically, I will not be able to tell sure it is this. Microscopy also I am not able to tell sure it is this, right? So what helps me here is nothing but age. So Robbins clearly mentions that if you have a giant cell involved, giant cells, granuloma in a large vessel, there are only two possibilities, Takayasu and your giant cell arteritis. Robbins says that if you have a patient less than 50 years, inclines towards Takayasu arteritis. That's what we will do in real life as well. I'm having a microscopy, a large vessel biopsy, showing all of the granulomas. If it's less than 50 years, Takayasu arteritis. I cannot rule out giant cell arteritis. Because most of the time, giant cell arteritis happens more than 50 years. So just age is the only criteria for me to differentiate these two, both clinically as well as microscopically, right? There will be overlap. So whatever you read in your textbooks may not be exactly the same thing. Like temporal arteritis, your headache might be the common finding, may not be the common finding, right? So when you go outside and practice as consultants, I don't want to get fixated on these most common terminologies, right? This is how generally it presents. None of the disease read textbooks, right? So they can present any way. You have to understand the basic ideology of the pathogens of the disease so you can extrapolate everything, right? So do remember this, age is the only important criteria to differentiate giant cell and Takayasu arteritis, right? So let's go to the next one. Vasculitis and granuloma. See, when I have a history of vasculitis and microscopy shows granuloma, actually there are almost many every vasculitis will have granulomas. Giant cell, Takayasu, Kawasaki biopsy is unlikely, Duodenus, yes. Schuchters, yes. I have many vasculitis which can have granulomas, right? So which takes me to the point, what are the vasculitis without granuloma, right? When I have no granulomas, what am I going to think of? There are few vasculitis I'm going to think of when there's no granuloma, which means I'm going to think of an acute disorder. So two things you should think of when you have no granuloma. One is PAN. Polyarteritis nodosa doesn't have a granuloma. It's a large medium vessel vasculitis which doesn't have granuloma. I'm sure you know other findings in PAN. Lung spread, renal artery involved, no glomerulonephritis, HPSAG suggests stroke PAN. These are just quick points regarding PAN. The other vasculitis, which may not have granuloma, is my microscopic polyangiitis, right? Microscopic polyangiitis or hypersensitive angiitis both mean the same. Other words, in microscopy, I will have WBCs, leukocytes, and broken WBC, debris. So we also call them as leukocytoclastic vasculitis. These two are the main vasculitis which might not have granulome on microscopy, fine. There are a few more for which I don't do a biopsy much. So these are the classical vasculitis which might not have a granuloma, fine. Okay, so now just we are going to diverge a little bit and discuss about vasculitis per se. We look at the vasculitis and look at all the microscopic, classical microscopic feature, and we'll come to a diagnosis, fine, one by one. As I said, giant cell arteritis, as well as your tracheostomy arteritis, will have giant cells and granuloma. I'm sure you must have easily diagnosed giant cells. You can easily do it. Multiple nuclei, multiple blue dots, right? So the pathognomonic feature for both of them are chronic inflammation, so there'll be tissue destruction. The tissue destruction is internal elastic lamina fragmentation. If you read Robbins, it must have been clearly mentioned that a fragmented internal elastic lamina on a BVG strain is pathognomonic for giant cell arteritis, 100%. Same thing will be seen in tracheostomy as well. Only reason is I don't take a subclavian artery biopsy. It's diagnosed radiologically. Fine, that's the thing. Fine, and there's a long-standing controversy. I want to put an end to the controversy. It's actually not a controversy. The biopsy length required for giant cell arteritis. There are two values: one in Robbins, one in Harrison's. Robbins says that take a biopsy of at least 1 centimeter to rule out giant cell arteritis, which means if we have to give a negative diagnosis, because biopsy diagnosis is must to continue the disease, not to start the treatment, to continue the treatment, biopsy is must, right? So in order to continue treatment, a tissue diagnosis is must. So if I have to report a negative report, it is not giant cell arteritis, I should have minimum of 1 centimeter biopsy, which because of the skip lesion nature of the disease, fine. What Harrison says is the numbers are different, 3 to 5 centimeter. So they say that I'm going to compare these two. Harrison is a better book, I'm going to go with that. No, not at all. Every textbook is based on evidence-based medicine. Every textbook, a standard textbook, will have the same content only. What Harrison says is the wordings are different. Harrison says that the yield in the diagnosis will be more when I'm having 3 to 5 centimeter biopsy. 100% correct. Yield is nothing but more chance of getting a positivity, right? So yield is totally different from the minimal requirement, obviously, right? Minimal requirement to rule out giant cell arteritis is 1 centimeter. If you still suspect giant cell arteritis, take a bigger biopsy, 3 to 5 centimeter, right? Both are different statements. Obviously, you'll have different lengths. There's no controversy here. So when you want to read the question, read what the question is asking for. Based on that, say it's 1 centimeter or 3.5 centimeter, right? Both are standard textbooks. Every standard textbook is based on evidence-based medicine, and evidence never goes wrong, right? So there's no controversy. The problem is we are not able to interpret it perfectly, fine? Okay, now we'll go to the microscopy. So this microscopy, if you look at this, and most of the images are from Robbins. See, this is a vessel. So if I say that this part, whatever I'm marking here, all these parts are pink acellular material, right? So this is fibrinoid necrosis. So I'm saying an active vasculitis here. When you look at this part of the thing, maybe I'll mark in a yellow color. Oh, yellow is not so bright. Okay, I'll go with red. So whatever this part is, right? All this part here, right? It's not having your fibrinoid necrosis, which means in the same vessel biopsy, I'm having one part having necrosis, other part is not. Maybe slight amount of fibrosis there, fine? So when I have variable ages of lesion, this is very, very important term, variable ages of lesion in the same vessel, or different vessel in the same person, which are temporally dissimilar lesions. Diagnosis is span. You should not think about anything else. My only diagnosis is span, because span has that peculiarity of having dissimilar, temporally dissimilar lesions. Actually, that also is the reason why this temporal dissimilar lesion. We have discussed that in the class. We'll soon discuss sometimes in the free lectures as well. Fine. If you are an Unacademy Plus subscriber, just go on to the blood vessel chapter and discuss in detail about span. You will have zero confusions after that. Everything will be crystal clear, fine. Then we'll go to this mic finding. What do you see here? I'm seeing here, definitely, I'm sure you must have picked this up, right? It's a very, very simple one. Granulomas, giant cells, right? I have lots of giant cells here. So this is giant cells, virginous, same finding. If your question says, okay, lung involvement, bilateral cavity, plus your renal involvement, glomerular involvement, which means small vessel, plus this finding, it's going to be virginous. Temporal artery involvement or whatever larger vessel involvement greater than 50 years, same biopsy, temporal arteries or giant cell arteritis. All the large vessel involvement less than 50 years, same biopsy, your tracheostomy arteritis, right? Biopsy is going to be the same, microscopy will be the same, but based on the history, I'm going to have a different diagnosis, fine? This is for giant cell artery, any arteritis or vasculitis with giant cell involvement, fine? Next, this. See here again, this is lumen here, fine? This is lumen for me, the lumen is intact a little bit. So what you're seeing here is, if I have to focus on this color, this cell especially, That's a WBC, that's a neutrophil, right? So I have an intact neutrophil, so I'm talking about an acute vasculitis, and I have lots of vessels here, lots of tiny, tiny debris here, right, in the vessel wall. I have broken vessels as well. So I have intact vessels, leukocytes, broken vessels, clastic, leukocytoclastic vasculitis. This is the microscopic feature of an microscopic polyangiitis, right, or hypersensitive angiitis. As I said, that it's also called as leukocytoclastic vasculitis because I have leukocytes and I have broken leukocytes. That's the terminology. Most of the acute vasculitis will be due to this. Fine. Okay, next image. Look at this image again. I have a superb vessel here. You can see the RBCs here. Though it's a low power image, if I'm going to have to concentrate on these cells, what I'm going to see in these cells are eosinophils, tiny eosinophils, right? I'm having eosinophils in a vasculitis. This might have Jane's cells also. This is your Schuck-Strauss syndrome. For this diagnosis, you will undoubtedly have a history of your asthma or allergic reaction. Asthma history plus vasculitis with eosinophilia, your Schuck-Strauss syndrome. The question of today's video is, tell me the drug, comment the drug which can cause Schuck-Strauss syndrome. We have a classical drug which can cause Schuck-Strauss syndrome. I want you to comment on that, fine? Next one, this image. Look at this image, this is also a vessel. We are going to arrive to the name of this vasculitis by looking at just at the image. I'm having a perfect vessel. Am I right in saying that in this lumen there is some problem? Yes, because I'm not having lumen. I'm having entirely something obstructing the lumen, right? Can I call this thrombus? If it's not a vasculitis, can I call this thrombus? Yes, it is thrombus. And I have an arrow mark here where if I'm going to concentrate on this area and this area, am I right in saying that there is more blue cells, blue color cells for a thrombus? Yes. Because thrombus will not have blue color cells, right? It's predominantly fibrin, acellular fibrin, and you have a lines of Zan. It's having thrombus, there's lots of blue color cells. These blue color cells are inflammation. So I'm saying I'm having thrombus, plus I'm having inflammation. Inflammation of the vessel, I'm going to call angiitis. The thrombus is obliterating the vessel. So it's simple. Thromboangiitis obliterans, a very, very classical diagnosis of a Burgess disease, right? Which is related to which etiology? Smoking etiology, fine? So we have quickly gone through the images of vasculitis, and you know how to differentiate vasculitis with granulomas. There are quite a few vasculitis without granulomas. We saw about them as well. And to end with, I'm repeating whatever I started in this start. Any vasculitis, large vessel will have Jane cells. Microscopy, clinically, it cannot differentiate. The only point of difference is age. Less than 50 years Takayasu, more than 50 years temporal arteries or Jane cell arteries. Fine. Thank you for listening. Do download the Unacademy app. We have lots of special classes by all the educators of Unacademy for your upcoming NEET and NEET PG. Hope the class will help you to brush up all the memories, right? So if you have any error in the recall of this question, please do comment below. We'll just definitely sit through, and if at all it changes the answer, we'll revisit the question and change the answer, fine? Thank you for your time. See you soon. Till then, bye-bye from Dr. Ranjith. Bye.